a controversial topic because even though gamma burst has been known for 50 years now, okay, the very origin of those gamma ray photons is still unclear. Okay. Let us start with what we actually know, a simple review. First of all, gamma ray emission, gamma ray burst, corresponds to enormous energy releases. As you can see from this plot here, number of gamma ray bursts versus energetics. As you can see, this is a subsample, but as you can see, the energy is typically generated at 1063 Hz, okay? With an energetic event that can approach 1064 Hz. These are isotropic energies, assuming isotropy, but let me remind you that nonetheless, they correspond to converting 0.1 once over mass into gamma ray photon, gamma ray photons, okay? We also know that gamma ray bursts are ultra relativistic sources, okay? They are the only ultra relativistic sources non-quantum physics. There are other relativistic sources, such as AGN, for example, in which Lorentz factors are of the order of 2, but Lorentz factors of gamma ray bursts are extreme. The sources have Lorentz factor the order of a few hundreds, okay? We know this by several lines of study. Probably the most one of the most important is this one. You remember that the after the emission shows this early link in the optical. Okay, this is the deceleration of the gamma ray burst ejector. At this time, the deceleration is at maximum level, and there is this peak of emission. There is a connection between the deceleration time, energy, and Lorentz factor, and density of the environment. But as you can see, this is the formula. As you can see from it, you can infer the value of gamma by measuring the deck and the deceleration time, okay, and having a good idea of E and N. However, gamma depends only weakly on N and the energy. So even if they are just estimates, the value for for gamma zero, the factor will be still quite precise. Another line of evidence is the fact that gamma burst prompt emission extends to the GRB bands. Okay, this is the typical spectrum of gamma burst here. Here is in photons, here is in energy, versus energy. Now, the CDC abundant 1 mega electron volt photons, but we also see, we also detect giga electron volt photons from gamma burst. We do not detect, except rare cases, we do not detect thermal emission or opacity due to production of pairs. Okay, you would expect that these photons interact with each other and produce pairs or even produce thermal emission. Okay. However, this is not seen in gamma ray bursts with rare exceptions. This is possible only if the Lorentz factor of the source is extremely large. Okay? This way, the real energy of the photons is much lower, and the cross section of the gamma E plus E minus reaction is much lower as well. Nothing else we know is about the size of the emission regions of these gamma ray photons. These are a sample of gamma ray light curves of gamma ray bursts. They are very, very different, but in any case, you can often see these very these spikes here. Okay, this is the count versus time. The typical variability time scale is of the order of 100 seconds. Okay. However, for very bright events, we also see variability at 10 millisecond level. Okay. Since there are realistic sources, you can tell the radius by this formula. I hope you remember it. The radius of the source, which is emitting photons with this variability and has a Lorentz factor gamma, is given by this formula here, and you get a typical region of the order 10 to 13 centimeters, which is roughly one astronomical unit. Okay. Something else we know that is very important is the correlation between the peak energy of gamma ray spectrum and the ISO, the energy emitted in gamma rays in total, assuming isotropy. The peak and the ISO, as you can see from this plot here, are narrowly coordinated, at least for longer gamma ray bursts. Short gamma ray bursts are a different story. But at least for long term levels, this is a very clear and defined relation. Okay? This is so precise, this relation called a Amati relation, from the name of the person that first studied it. It is so precise, this relation between the peak and the ISO, that even if you break down the gamma ray light curve into small pieces, okay? You measure the ISO, that small piece of the light curve, and the peak energy, this relation still applies. Okay? So it works everywhere, in spikes, plateau, the light curves, whatever. So actually, one could say that not the peak is closer to the ISO, but the peak is closer to luminosity. ISO to 1. Okay. Another important bit is that the spectral components in this mysterious gamma ray prompt emission. This is a plot, a sketch of what we actually see from 1 keV up to about this is 1 GB. This is 100 GB. Okay? GBM and LAT are the names of the two instruments on board the Fermi mission that provides most of this spectrum. Usually see this component, a single smoothly broken power plot, this one component one, the so-called band function. Okay? It has been known for 25 years now. And this is common, you find it almost in all gamma ray bursts. Then there is this component, the component number two, which is narrow, and it is narrow, as you see, it's only a few tenths, only two, three orders of magnitude in energy, while the band function extends from 1 dB to 100 dB. Okay? This is narrow, and the slopes are those of thermal emission. Okay? Then there is this other component number three, which is a simple power law component that again extends from 1 dB to 100 dB. Okay? All the way with the same slope. The few are rare. But as you shall see, they are very important to tell us what's going on in gamma ray bursts from emission. Something else we know that gamma GB emission usually begins and ends later than MAB emission. Sorry if this plot is not very clear, but this is the gamma ray emission at low energies, okay? More higher and higher energy until you get to the GB range. As you can see, there is a delay a delay between the proton, the emission is seen in the EB and KB band, and the emission seen in the GRB. Not only that, once the proton emission in the EB and MB is over, okay, the GRB emission carries on, continues. Okay? This basically means that the gamma ray spectrum evolves with time. It's not constant. Yes, you can make a global average spectrum, but if you slice the light and make a spectra for each temporal slice, as you can see in this plot here, you get different spectrum. Different spectra. In particular, the pink one is derived at late time. As you can see, you see this component here, the power loop. The green one is at the red one, and the green one are derived at the fox. As you can see, they show this the band component only. Okay. Sometimes this power loop component shows this cutoff at 100 GB. Okay. This is called here. In order to study this quantum emission, we have to have some clear ideas about what the basic physics. Okay, so we know that we have a relativistic expansion of a very hot plasma. Okay, the so-called fireball. In gamma ray bursts, we often hear this term. In gamma ray burst astronomy, we often see this term fireball. Okay, this hot plasma, hot sphere of plasma, which is a expanding. Now, if you give an energy at zero to an outflow of mass and zero, such that it is much lower than zero divided by square, suppose that you give this energy to this mass, okay? It less mass, it rest. Energy much less than the energy you are giving. Everything within initial radius are zero. So you have an initial commuting temperature T prime zero. Okay. Basic fluid dynamics tell us that the temperature, okay, will evolve with volume V. T to be time prime proportional to volume 1 minus gamma A, where gamma A is the aerobatic index for this kind of gases. Okay? It is equal to 4 thirds. Since, of course, the volume increases as a radius to the cube, you plug it here, and you get that T prime will be proportional to R to the minus 2 minus 1. The commuting temperature is decreasing linearly with radius. On the other hand, okay, you also know that, by the way, temperature is proportional to one factor of the electrons in the rest frame of the fiber. On the other hand, you know that total energy must be conserved. Okay? It means that gamma prime, which is the Lorentz factor of the electrons, which measures internal energy, multiplied by gamma, the Lorentz factor of this expanding fireball, okay, must be constant. So if this one is decreasing as radius minus 1, gamma must increase the Lorentz factor, gamma must increase as a radius. In other words, the outflow will expand and accelerate, converting internal kinetic energy into bulk kinetic energy. Okay? Of course, this acceleration cannot go on forever. It will stop at a certain time. And it will stop when we have converted all of the internal kinetic energy into bulk kinetic energy. So if eta is the ratio between E0 and mass and the initial mass of the ejection, the other by square, the maximum Well, it starts to be gamma max about eta, and it will be reached at a certain radius, which is Rs proportional to gamma zero. The so-called this Rs is called saturation radius. Okay? Beyond this saturation radius, the gamma, the Bernstein factor, does not increase anymore. And you can split the evolution of gamma versus radius in this basic problem. Okay? For radius larger than Rs, the outflow is not accelerated anymore. We talked about costing phase. Shells, these red hot plasma, at certain point will start to spread. Okay? Suppose that the initial shell width is delta L proportional to roughly delta R0 or R0 simply. Okay? At the very beginning, the width is simply the radius in which are releasing the energy. Now, the spread will occur following this formula here. Okay, C is minus D divided by C, which is roughly gamma to minus two. It means that delta L over R, which is proportional to delta T over T, will be roughly gamma to minus two. So the bottom line is that this spreading is very, very slow, because gamma is of the order of your. For typical R0, the order 10 to the 17 centimeters, and gamma less than 1,000, this spreading, this delta L, less than negligible, and the shell maintains more or less the same width. Okay? However, at very high radius, the spreading will become much important. And as you can see from this formula, delta L proportional to R dB over C, R delta, this is again, this quantity here is M to minus 2, eta to minus 2. So you can infer that when this condition is actually reached, then R delta, the radius to which you see this spreading, is R squared, is eta squared multiplied by the original radius R0. Remember that Rs is already eta R0, so it means that the spreading radius R delta is eta Rs, that is 300-400 times more. Okay? This is captured by this basic scheme. Well, we are also interested in what happens in the moving frame, okay, in which the shell width delta prime is gamma by the observer width. So again, you take this formula here and you divide by gamma and obtain these three different cases. They give you the values of delta prime when R is less than Rs, when R is between Rs and R delta, and when R is larger than R delta. Why we are so complicating our lives? Because from this formula, we find out the evolution of the internal energy of this fiber, which will then produce the observed energy. Okay. From the expressions for delta L from the width of the shell, you can infer the co-moving volume of the shell. Okay. So this formula is basically the previous formula, it's basically this formula here, but multiplied by four pi r12, and again derive three different expressions for the evolution of the moving volume. First is proportional to r cube, then to r squared, and then to r cube again. Now we can find how the temperature or the internal energy of this fiber evolves with time with respect to the original values, V0 and V0, because We are just to divide the initial energy by the evolution of the volume. And again, you get this formula here. It's just a noise, it's just a very, very basic algebra. Okay? But it is important to note that the internal energy, okay, is basically constant up to, it decreases with radius initially, and then it will keep decreasing, but at a lower rate, and then it will start to decrease again at higher rate. Okay, so far so good, but what are these delta R0 and R0? But this is stated here. Remember, we are releasing a certain energy in zero and mass in zero with initial entropy eta equal to the ratio between the two quantities inside a region of size delta r zero about r zero. Okay, then this very hot ball of plasma starts to expand, but at the very beginning, delta t zero, the time that it takes for light to go across this ball, is delta r zero divided by c. Okay, but how much is delta r zero? This is important. Basically, r zero is on the order of 10^17 centimeters. Okay, this is calculated assuming that this energy is released in a region whose radius is the same of a black hole of mass 10 solar masses. As we can see, as we see the next class, okay, we think that the central energy that releases this huge this fiber are typically black holes with this mass, 10 solar mass. So this R0, this original radius, is of the order of 10^7 mass of black hole divided by 10 centimeters. And the original T0 will be of the order 3^-4 m1 seconds. Okay? So this is the minimal variability you can have in the central engine activity. Okay? As we see in a minute, it also means that the light curve gamma reverse from the emission cannot have variability lower than 3^-4 seconds. Okay, next step. Okay, there is this fiber, okay, which is dominated by electrons associated with two protons. So number of electrons is roughly equal to the number of protons, okay? Forget about pairs for now. These electrons, of course, will produce an opacity, and the emission coming from this fiber will be thermal. Okay? If the environment is optically dim, which is when tau, the optical depth for photons and scattering is larger than one. Now, optical depth is quite easy. It's number, basically number of particles multiplied by sigma t, which is the cross-section of photons scattering between photons and electrons. And it is basically this quantity here, if you compare it with the previous equation. You see that tau zero, the original opacities, is given by this formula here, until radius is less than the spreading radius of that. Okay? This is still an opacity. Okay, it's the original opacity of the fiber, and the opacity of the fiber will be at any time, at any radius, will be the original opacity multiplied by spreading by width divided by r squared. Now, from this formula, we can infer the radius r at which tau will be equal to 1. That is when the photons will be free to leave the fiber, when the fiber will not be optically thick anymore. Okay? We just plug tau equal to 1 in this formula here. Okay? In the first case, you assume that the ejecta are made of shells. Okay, this fiber is made of many shells. You assume that each one each shell is produced in a delta T0 (3×10⁻⁴ seconds and has energy of 10⁻⁴ Hz. And from the photospheric radius will be derived from this formula here, again plugging this quantity must be by imposing that this quantity must be 1. You derive this formula from here. You remember how much is tau 0. And finally we derive that the photosphere radius is 3×11 centimeters. Okay? Multiply m1×1, the larger the mass of the black hole, the lower the smaller this radius. And this proportional to E divided by eta to 1/2. But take home this quantity here, 3×11 centimeters. Okay? At this radius, the typical fiber is finally able to release photons, which will not be thermal. Okay? Before this radius, a photon must be thermal, but we do not observe thermal emission gamma levels. So emission must come after this 3×11 centimeters. For now, in a more general case, for very long gamma bursts can last hundreds of seconds. Okay, we can think of a continuous wind. Okay, the outflow will have this dimensionless entropy, eta L, which is L, this L is proportional is luminosity divided by m dot divided by gravity square. Again, this thing will accelerate the energy, will reach a maximum speed of eta at the saturation radius, the same thing that we just seen. The equation for E and T, and the temperature will be the same that we have just seen, but the equation for opacity are a bit different. Now, number of protons and so of electrons is simply m dot divided by 4 pi r squared mp c gamma, which will also be fair in terms of luminosity. The Thomson scattering depth is given by this formula here. Okay? If you substitute this ne with this ne here, you finally obtain that Thomson scattering is luminosity multiplied by sigma Thomson cross section is divided by this quantity here. Again, if you impose that this quantity is 1, you find the photospheric radius. And you find that it's a bit larger than it was before. It's of the order 5.5×12 centimeters. Okay? With the same carrying as before. Note that you have other 52, luminosity in terms of 10^52 Hz per centimeter, and eta^-1, gamma. The burden of the stack to the minus two. Now, follow me because it's an important point. If the photosphere occurs before the end of acceleration, that is, if this photospheric radius is less than saturation radius, it means that some of the photons which are accelerating this plasma, okay, will find freedom, will be free to escape. Okay? But these photons were still thermal. Okay? So if we have this condition, half radius is less than saturation radius, bright thermal emission should be produced. Okay? And these photons, energy, cannot accelerate balance anymore. You have your maximum Lorentz factor, gamma max, when these two quantities are equal, okay? Since you know that the saturation radius is n star multiplied by r zero, and you and you know are F in this contract here, you feel instead that this Lorentz factor maximum you can derive is about on the order of 100, does not, sorry, 1000, does not depend much on the other parameters. So we have two different cases for photospheric radiation. If the initial entropy, okay, eta, is larger than 2 minus 3, the photosphere is within the saturation radius, so the thermal radiation luminosity will be a lot. We can easily derive how much is it by applying standard first year formula. But the important point is that it is the luminosity of the thermal emission will be roughly proportional to the luminosity of the center engine, which is producing the fiber. That is 10 to 52, 10 to 53, 10 to 54 air per second, okay? Which is a lot. Temperature will be again given by standard formula, and it will be in the range of 1 mega electron-volt or a bit less. This is the simple direction of the random test. Okay? To derive this formula, we have just used those values, those unknown case of gamma, E, in fact, temperature prime, as they change with the values here shown a bit before. Now, what happens is that if eta, the entropy of the system, is less than 10 to the 3, the photosphere is actually. Photosphere value is larger than saturation radius. You still have some thermal radiation, but it is much less. Okay? This is given again by standard formula, and then finally it is the luminosity of central engine, tau. This is the original radius, the luminosity of central engine, eta to the a third. This is the initial entropy, which would be the Lorentz factor of the ejector. See this heavy dependence here, up to the 8th. Temperature will be given by this formula here, again it depends on e to the third, and it will be on the order of, sorry, temperature will be on the order again of the mega electron volt, okay? And the peak flux will be luminosity divided by distance divided by peak frequency. And it will be on the order of 1 milli for typical parameters. Okay? This peak thermal flux is this one, is independent from eta. Okay? It doesn't matter how much energy you gave to the fiber initially, and it's only really depending on L. Okay? This quantity here is roughly the same gamma ray flux we measure in the mega electron volt band. So it should be detectable in systematic observational campaigns. Okay? If you take 1,000 spectrum from the emission, you should see this emission because it is roughly the same order of magnitude as the gamma ray emission. But as I said earlier, it is not visible, it's not there, at least not very often. So the absence of this thermal emission has important implications. To make thermal emission negligible, okay, you need eta less than a few tens. Okay? Remember that eta is the same thing as the Bird-Lorentz factor above a certain radius. But we know already from those pieces of observations I showed you earlier that this is not true. Another possibility then is that there is little initial radiation to accelerate the jet. The acceleration can be driven not by photons that push this fiber so that it expands, but this acceleration is obtained by other means, for example, the release of a magnetic field in the outflow. We see it here. Of the emission, so called internal shock model, okay, or IS for short. You have these shells produced by the central engine, but these shells are moving at different Lorentz factor, okay? So suppose that shell number 2, with the Lorentz factor 2, gamma 2, is moving faster than shell number 3, but these two gamma are more or less the same, but gamma 2 is larger than gamma 3, okay? The distance here will be simply C per variability time, the center length. So these two things, at certain point, will collide. It is you cannot escape. They will collide at certain time. And from the realistic dynamics, you find that this condition time will be roughly C T variability gamma squared of these shells. Okay. When this happens, since there will be internal shock waves, these two things will impact and they will drive shock waves inside them. The final Lorentz factor, if these two shells merge, okay, if they become one, the final gamma will be gamma 2, gamma 3, up to 1/2. This comes from conservation of momentum, okay? But by applying this, you can derive how much energy is actually lost in this kind of process. And for example, for gamma 2, 200, gamma 3 is 50. The efficiency, the amount of energy converted divided by the total energy, okay, is of the order of 20%. Now, shock accelerates electrons. Electrons will then re-emit the energy that they have received. So basically, you are converting the bulk kinetic energy of these shells into internal energy of electrons via electric shocks, and this energy is emitted by some sort of emission process. This emission process is usually assumed to be synchronous. Okay? But before that, let me quickly summarize what are the pros and cons of the IS model. First of all, they may introduce the fast variability of the light curves, because T ops is the collision radius divided by 2 gamma square C. Okay, remember, I hope you remember this formula from the previous talk I had last time. But this RC itself is about 2 gamma. Is a gamma square T bar C. So as a result, the observational variability, the time scale of variability, is about the same as the variability of the central energy. The central energy, central metric, is like to be a newly born black hole with an accretion disk or magma, and the initial outflow must be very unsteady. Okay? The variability time scale of this object will be again at 0 divided by C, where at 0 is the 10 to the 7 centimeters. It is the radius of the last stable orbit around a black hole with about 10 solar masses. So this variability is about 10 to the -4 seconds. So finally, this simple assumption, you can explain the fast variability of light curves, okay, of gamma ray light curves. But since the IRS model has a very huge problem, has several problems, but the most important is efficiency. I told you that the typical efficiency is of the order of 20%, okay? But by studying gamma ray bursts afterwards and prompt emission, we know that the efficiency can reach up to 90%. Okay? And it's impossible to reproduce. Plus, we still don't know the nature of this emitting radiation. Is it synchronous, jitter radiation, self-synchronous quantum? As we shall see in a minute, none of these things seems able to work. Synchronous emission from internal shock. Okay. Remember that typically the bulk function, the prompt emission, is a broken power. Whenever you see broken power in the spectrum, you think synchrotron emission. If you divide the energy that these electrons have after the shock by the typical power, you derive the so-called cooling time, okay? Which is typically on the order of 10 to minus 7 seconds. Meaning that electrons, they lose all their energy when they are just accelerated. These are the energy densities in the magnetic field, radiation and electrons. But this is the important point. The cooling time is the order of 10 to minus 7. Okay? And once you have accelerated an electron, this system, you do not re-accelerate it. Okay? So this system is quite, first of all, this is not very efficient. Second, if the cooling time is so short, it means that all the emission you are seeing is above the cyclotron cooling frequency you see. But this cannot be true, because if this emission were above the cooling frequency you see, the low energy spectrum is low. You remember the band function has that slope. The first slope is about zero. The second is here actually. It's about between minus one and zero. And the second slope is about two, that slope. However, by synchrotron, including after a frequency above the cooling frequency, alpha is minus three, is minus three, three hours, which you can see here. Okay. So in principle, you should not have alpha, the low energy spectral index, harder than minus 1.5. But as you can see, all these numbers have low energy spectral index alpha, which is harder than the value of the synchrotron the spectral index predicted by a synchrotron model. The problem is actually even worse, because in synchrotron theory, you cannot produce alpha, which is harder than minus two thirds. Okay? If you are below the synchrotron peak frequency. This is called the synchrotron line of death. It has been shown here. But again, loss gamma bursts show spectra harder than its alpha minus 2 ter, which is, let me remind you, the harder spectral index we can produce in synchrotron theory. Okay? Some solutions have been proposed. For example, we are in synchrotron self-absorption regime. Electrons are re-accelerated. There is jitter radiation. Some of these solutions are reasonable, some are not, but all have problems. Okay? This is another problem. I have no time to explain in detail. The synchrotron emission from thermal shock will not follow the amount direction. This is a very important bug to the system. So people looked around for other solutions. For example, the same synchrotron emission from internal shock. You start from the peak frequency the peak frequency in the synchrotron emission, which is given by the quantity here. You can write it like that. V is magnetic field, gamma V is Lorentz factor of electrons. This is the Burke-Lorentz factor. Okay. The peak synchrotron flux is given by this quantity here. Again, this is standard synchrotron theory. Okay. The peak of the self-compton emission, okay, self-synchrotron compton emission, will be this peak frequency multiplied by gamma square E. That is, these electrons produce gamma ray photons. And these gamma ray photons scatter on the same photons, okay, of the same electrons that have produced them, and end up with this peak energy. The peak flux is is this quantity here multiplied by tau e. Tau e is the Thomson opacity. Okay? So again, you play. So again, you derive equations, one for the synchrotron peak frequency, another one for the synchrotron peak flux. And you also impose that the relative cooling time is less than the dynamical time scale of the system, that T cool is less than a few hundred seconds. Okay? I mean, you have these two equations, and you look for a solution, and you get this complex table here, but do not be afraid to visit it, because actually it's quite, the method is quite easy. I hope you are familiar with the Lorentz, the constant parameters. Why? It tells you how much scattering there is between photons and electrons. Okay. You must have y approximately one. I'll tell you in a second why. Okay. Otherwise, you will have photons of even higher and higher and higher high energy. So to have y is about one, from this equation here, you need the radius of the order 10 to 16 centimeters, okay? Or it is a large factor of 200. So tau on e is its radius is 10 to 16, gamma is 200. Y is about 1, get this tau on e is about 5, 10 to minus 5. But this means that the peak of the self-synchrotron proton emission is 10 to 5 times weaker than the synchrotron. Okay? So self-synchrotron proton does not work, you already see it from here. Moreover, the self-synchrotron proton, the electrons, you have these electrons that first produce synchrotron radiation, okay? The peak of this emission will be in the optical range, a few electron volts, okay? And does not depend on the parameters. So it means basically that if the bright gamma ray prompt emission is produced by this, is eventually produced by this optical electrons producing optical photons, the optical photons must be huge, a huge number of them. You should see a very bright optical emission, but this is wrong. We do not observe such enormous optical fluxes. Okay? Of course, you can say, well, it does make y bigger, the tau e, if you make y bigger, then tau e the decreases. But larger y implies a lot of energy radiated in very high energies. Okay? While only 10% of gamma bursts are outside by Fermi lab. There are additional problems in this system. Cooling time is still too fast. The slopes of the spectrum are not correct. The so-called Gray-Michina correction can make up the spectrum, but you need again very large y. So bottom line, S self-synchrotron proton does not work. And people try to see look at this other possibility, which I think was a bit clever. Okay. You remember the band function, this mutually broken power. Okay? What if this band component is itself a thermal emission? Is a photospheric emission modified by the inverse quantum process itself? Now the band spectrum is not a black body. However, the inverse quantum can modify the black body spectrum and make it look like a broken power. But think of a gas of photons in thermal distribution and distribution of energy interacting with thermal electrons just below the solar sphere. A tell you in a second why, just below. Protons will be scattered on electrons via inverse quantum. For quantum parameter y, much less than 1, the emergent photon spectrum will be still thermal, modified at higher energy only as a power. It means that the energy, at low energy, the spectral slope is wrong. Okay? You get the high energy slope, okay? But the low energy shape is wrong because it's thermal and the band spectrum is not thermal. Okay. If y is much less than 1, the energy photon spectrum will be like that of the electrons. But electrons by hypothesis are thermal, so again the thermal spectrum wrong. If y is approximately 1 and the opacity is about 10, the energy photons will have scattered about a few tens of times. Okay? You have these photons that takes 10-50 scatters before the bending to escape. We don't have gained a lot of energy by scattering only a few tens of times. Okay? The peak of this inverse quantum, new IC, to be given by this formula here, and the high energy index given by this formula here, and for y is about 1, you get minus 0.5, which is approximately correct. This is the formula for the high energy index, and minus 0.5 is approximately what we have to see. But the low energy part of the spectrum is wrong, because this is what we think we should see. It is possible to demonstrate that a thermal spectrum modified by IC just below the photosphere represents this kind of band. This is luminosity, this is frequency. You see this band here. It means that the spectrum here is not minus 1, alpha is not minus 1 as we see in gamma and gamma reverse, but it is about 0. Okay? This is in energy. Think of the same spectrum in photons. Okay? This conclusion is not altered even if you consider superposition effects, for example, adject to different luminosity and regions. Another problem: it is difficult to. If you have only a few tens of scatters. Okay, they're not giving a lot of energy to these photons. But gamma reverse are able to produce photons of the energy of 100 gigaelectron volt. This is difficult to obtain. People still like the photospheric models, though, because, for example, it may explain why the peak energy, remember the amount of direction, is a few hundreds of kiloelectron volts. This peak energy is given in the photospheric model, is basically the temperature of the photosphere. Okay? I hope this is one formula I will show you. Okay? You see, it is about right. But we have counter examples. For example, we have thermal reverse, which in peak reached 50 mega electron volts, and we cannot explain this. The peak of this formula, because other parameters here, N52, and where we did time values were actually typical. However, one thing that the photospheric model writes is that it works out the amount of relation between the peak photon energy and the isotropic energy. Simulations with different stellar models, these are all. People have started from a star, okay? A 16 solar star, a 35 solar star. They assume different jet luminosities, different Lorentz factor, different activity time of the jet. But every time they have done this, once the jet goes out of the star or the massive stellar progenitor, dissipation occurs at the very the eye. And this dissipation is observed for this model, you can reproduce dramatic reaction. You have just to assume that emission comes from different regions. And different regions of the dramatic reaction can be explained assuming the different viewing angle. You have to assume that you are not seeing the jet, the ejecta is actually on axis, but you are slightly off axis by a few degrees. And you explain the dramatic reaction. Another important model, which is, I think is quite probably one of our best shot to best attempt to explain the gamma universe, is so-called internal condition magnetic convection turbulence model, horrible name, but it's so-called Ickmatt model. Okay, in the Ickmatt model, you assume that there is more energy in pointing flux than in variance. The ejecta have a huge magnetic fields, okay? They carry much more energy in magnetic field than they carry in variance. This sigma is the ratio between flux, the ratio between the pointing flux and the energy, the variable flux is can be a few tens. Okay? Now suppose you have shells with this very high magnetic fields. Okay, which are oriented like that. Shells interact, they smash into each other. And then when they smash, okay, the magnetic fields are tangled up. Okay? The order magnetic lines are tangled up. Okay? This happens more or less at the same radius as it's the same process actually, as an internal shock radius, 10 to 13, 10 to 14 centimeters. Okay? When you have this tangled magnetic fields, at a certain point, fields of different polarity, north and south, will encounter each other. And when this happens, you have a very strong phenomenon that we see in the sun. Okay? Solar flares, very bright events, are due to these tangled magnetic lines that from north and south, at a certain point, smash into each other. This is a so-called reconnection of the magnetic field B. At the very beginning, only this energy, the energy released by reconnection creates more turbulence. Okay, it perturbates the magnetic field lines even more. This in turn will make things even messier, which will cause further turbulence, but it's a runaway process. Okay? The connection can also occur if you smash two shells in tangled magnetic fields. Suppose this one shell is another shell. This is the magnetic field, the first shell, magnetic field another shell. These things will have different polarities. And this will trigger violent reconnection. Okay? This is a sketch of what we should see. In this reconnection, there is a lot of energy released, there is very strong magnetic fields. So particles are accelerated and emit synchrotron radiation. The condition to release gamma-burst-like energy on the right time scale is that the coherence length of these tangled lines follows this formula here, which is gamma is an factor of electrons. Velocity of the jet or instructor. This coherence length over which there is a reconnection must be much smaller than the radius of the jet. So we need a lot of impacts. But these impacts are provided by internal shock. So this model basically retains the good point of internal shock because it has a very small variability time, the order 10 to minus 4 seconds. Okay? But it has a much higher efficiency. The efficiency is given by this formula here. And if you have sigma, if you have a lot of energy, magnetic field at the beginning, a little at the end, say here is 10, here is 1, then the efficiency will be as high as 90%. So it has a good point of internal shock, but it is better than internal shock when it comes to efficiency. Because remember, internal shock is a system of the 10-20%. Acceleration can occur multiple times, while internal shock model it happens only once. Fast cooling is basically avoided because you can accelerate electrons many times. The annihilation, as you can see from this formula here, the e-peak and luminosity is roughly recovered, okay? There are other parameters to take into account, but at least we are happy to see this thing here. There is a problem, okay? Nothing is perfect. Different from the emission process spikes could correspond to different dissipation events occurring in different regions, okay? The other spikes will be produced in different conditions. So in different conditions, in different regions, there will be different energies, different sizes, different magnetic fields. So each spike should behave differently from any others. But if you look at the spikes, you see that they are all similar. The spikes of emission are all similar. And all obey the relation. And this model cannot explain this very well. Because there are these other parameters to take into account that can be different from one region to another region. Then we have the problem, the origin of the non-bound components. The component number two, component number two. This component here, spectral indices are consistent with black body origin. Okay? Also, analyzing this component in short time intervals, you see that this peak moves as you expect in the so-called multicolor black body emission. Okay? You have many black bodies at different temperatures, and each one you produce a slightly different black body spectrum. Component 3, this one is more complicated. In the small sample of that burst is always coupled with component 2. It extends from kilo electron volts to giga electron volts with the same spectral flops over 9 orders of magnitude. Okay? Slope on nu and nu is positive. It means that most of energy is at very high frequencies. So we have to explain how we can give so much energy at GRB or hundreds of GRB photons. Okay? We have this, and then we have this cutoff here that gradually increases each time. Initially it's low, then the cutoff increases as time goes by. Okay, this is what we know. We also know that there is the same spectral flow, so the same mechanism must produce this component from the GB to the all the way to the GB GB line. Okay. So this power law shape indicates non-thermal origin. Okay. So it might be the same non-thermal process which is producing, for example, the could be cyclone emission, okay? Could be self-cyclone if it works. Same component which is producing the band component, just in different conditions, okay? But the important point actually we have found is that this component 3 is always associated with component 2, which is there. If you break the light curves, and you break and you build the spectra, okay, in small slices, at 1 second, at 2 second, at 3 second, you see that component 2 and component 3 track each other. They behave in the same way. So people, a few people think that the component 3 may be the just upstarted, for example, live response from component 2, does not work well, however, for low energy index. Remember all the problems we had for the low energy index when we talked about the best constant over thermal photospheric emission. The rising cutoff is easy to explain because by the expansion of the firewall, as you increase the radius, you decrease the opacity, for example due to pairs, and the high energy photons can escape. Okay? This is the easy part. The later remember I told you that the GB emission anyway has a delay with respect to the limit. But a few people think that this late GB emission could be afterglow emission. Because afterglow emission, that means the interaction with, due to the interaction between the ejector and the stellar medium, okay, this starts a few seconds, a few tens of seconds after the prompt emission, after the trigger. So this explanation, this standard shock explanation, accounts well, is good for temporal characteristics such as the delay onset, the extended duration, because the event afterglow emission, extended shock emission, basically afterglow emission, can last hundreds, thousands of seconds. You can also explain this behavior, this tip, this power law, this power law decay. Okay, and that after the emission is power loss in time. Okay. However, look at this formula here. Acceleration time as a function of gamma n and energy of the object. In a few cases, okay, this power law, this GB emission. The formula power law starts as early as one second. If you plug 1 second here and you infer gamma zero, you will get something for the energy of this burst. Okay, you get the noise factor, emission noise factor, the order of 6,000. We are not talking of noise factor of a few hundreds. We are talking of noise factor of 6,000 here. Many theoreticians think that it's not possible to achieve the noise factor of 6,000. Okay? Another thing, look at the, this is the point emission that GDB and UV and GB. Okay? See that during the mega electron volt phase, let's call it, the GB emission tracks the GB emission tracks the GB emission. Okay, you see a peak in the GB range, you see a peak in the GB. Okay, and this is difficult to achieve with standard shock models, because the standard shock models first our emission is a radius which is much larger than the radius of the internal shocks, and the Lorentz factor is much smaller, so you cannot relativistically contract times as effectively as the prompt emission. So people think that here you have GB emission, which is the same emission, the same component which is produced in prompt emission. At late epochs, the standard shock emission kicks in and produces this nice power loss. Okay? So, directions of future research. What we can do to know more? Well, magnetic field is present in the ejector, electromagnetic radiation will present polarization. Okay? Emission coming from sources that have a very strong magnetic field will be polarized. Okay? So if we study the polarization of the front gamma ray emission, we study the polarization during the peak, the optical peak, when the emission during the peak of the afternoon emission, the acceleration time, when the emission comes from the ejector, okay, we should see polarization. It is important to note that in very few cases, unfortunately, we have seen polarized emission. So we know for sure that the ejector had a stronger magnetic field. Okay? So this goes into the direction of that Ekmark model with the dissipation of magnetic energy. Future detectors such as the Cherenkov telescope array, CTA, will have sensitivities 10 times further than in the GRB range. This will allow us to study of the GRB emission that will give us views about the high-energy behavior. Okay? And in the future, we also have satellites such as GOM, LOFT, and TCEUS. Yes. A few years from now, that we study the low energy KeV emissions of front emission. I hope that by now you have understood that this is a key point. What happens to low energy, okay, defines whether a model is correct by force or not. That famous factor indices can be studied that will be studied by this mission. So these are my conclusions. Sorry, I should say something else. We also in the future even today we are doing a lot of simulations with computers. For example, magnetic dissipation, okay, the process of this Ekmark model. What happens? This Ekmark model, okay, we are studying magnetic dissipation. We are studying how magnetic energy is released into radiation. And this is not something you can capture entirely with formula in a linear way. You need computers, okay? Computers that we run simulations. Even this one, even the photospheric emission, okay? You can model it with formula up to a point, but beyond a certain point, you need computers. So in the future, okay. For now, we still don't know what produces this gamma ray emission. After 50 years of studies and investigation. The typical Wundt broken power law, the so-called one function, is still a challenge. Simple synchrotron, self-synchrotron quantum, IC photosphere models have problems. More sophisticated version of this magnetic dissipation model and IC photosphere may provide a better explanation, but they still have problems. I hope I made it clear. Future directions will be study of high energy, HE, and low energy, and the observations of front emission from gamma ray burst and simulations with computers. Okay. There are many questions. By the way, this is a very complicated subject, okay? Front emission of gamma ray burst is something studied by a lot of theoreticians, and what I've shown here is just a tiny summary of people. There are many models that I've not shown you, because people have tried to explain this front emission in many, many ways. Nobody has managed to explain. So we have had lots of other models. For example, interaction between protons and photons, they produce pions, and pions produce gamma ray. or people have thought of relativistic ejector that interact with field photons and produce gamma ray by inverse quantum. There are people thought about neutrons that decay and they change the dynamics of the ejector. And this way you can produce the light waves and the spectrum. But many other models. But there is no models that really manage to explain the prompt emission well. This is still a matter of debate. Some models have a better odds, but they are not perfect. Okay, that's it. If you have any questions, I'm happy to take them.
You said that the energy is high, that could be explained by the fireball having a larger radius for that, you know, high energy photon. Oh. You said that when the peak energy is high, the fire that could be explained by a larger radius fireball, so the photons can escape.
The cutoff energy, not the
peak. Yeah, the cutoff energy. But my question is that if the fireball radius is high, would that imply anything about the ignition or the objective itself? Like, why would the fireball radius be high, for example? Would that give any implication on the object or on the ignition afterwards?
Well, we tell you that the radius of the fireball is big enough so that you decrease the opacity. But what exactly has launched that fireball, you don't know. You would know, however, that the fireball at that time must have a certain radius. Okay? So you can go back in time at zero, try to know what was the original radius of the fireball. And if you manage to find that the original radius of the fireball is of the order, for example, 10 to 7 centimeters, well, this is consistent with the hypothesis that you must have a very compact object, such as a black hole or a magneto that produces this.
So, bugün ödev alıyor musunuz sizden? Geçen sene ödevler So last time we discussed already how the neutron superfluid in the neutron star rotates by forming an array of contact vortices. How the superconducting protons rotate without forming anything like a vortex or flux line, simply by forming a boundary layer with currents that sets up a tiny magnetic field inside the superconductor that then sets up a rotation pole. The field needed is very small. Okay, we show that. So rotation for the neutrons, vortex lines, for the proton, superfluid, the London field. We check the energy costs of these, and these are very small energies compared to the energy gain you get by rotating the system. Okay, so the cycles. And then we move on to the next question, which is about the magnetic flux on the neutron star. I think I gave this to you as a previous homework. When you have a total amount of flux on a many component object, the lowest free energy situation is then that total flux enters all components of the system with equal flux density. That means equal local magnetic field. You prove that in order, right? So when we look at the neutron star, the neutron star has a very large magnetic field going from 10 to the 8 Gauss in the millisecond pulsars, 10 to the 12 Gauss in the usual young neutron stars, to 10 to the 14 Gauss in magnetic. In all cases, it's an approximate conservation law that this total amount of flux on the neutron star has to remain on the system, because it can only diffuse out by Maxwell's equations by going through the conductivity of the outer crust of the neutron star, and that conductivity, like in all stars in astrophysics, is huge. That means the corresponding diffusion times for the magnetic flux to be expelled out of the neutron star are very, very low, so it doesn't happen. So we are in a situation where the total flux on the neutron star is there pretty much forever, for very long times. So the favored energy state, the minimum free energy state, is to have this flux shared with the proton superconductor. Okay? So I think that's where we were last time.
And now let's move down to that part of the lectures. Now, we have to have this magnetic moment or flux, and that has to be distributed with equal local fields. How shall we do that? Now, as we already discussed, in a superconductor, actually any charged system, it doesn't matter whether it's normal or superconductor, okay? Like the same applies if you are studying atoms in a magnetic field. Okay. The velocity is 1 over the mass times the canonical momentum. And the canonical momentum, take account of the balance force, means coupling to the vector potential with such a term. Okay. Left hand side is the true actual velocity of motion of the particles. Right hand side has two contributions, one from the gradient of the quantum mechanical wave function, this function phi is some function, and the other one is directly the vector potential. Now, we want to have We need to have a vector potential. We are looking for a way so that we have a non-zero equilibrium local magnetic field B, whose value is something like 10 to the 12 Gauss. Okay? That means we also have some large value of the vector potential A. Okay? For this to be true, the vector potential is going to be a combination of this term and that term, because this combination is equal, right? Now, if you don't have this term, that means corresponding to 10 to the 12 Gauss field, or the
is equal to vector potential, you will have to have the protons moving. Let us see what velocity would be. We have axial symmetry around about the magnetic axis or the magnetic moment axis, all right? So the star wants to have, or at least a normal component, the crust has, we observe it from the outside, a magnetic moment in this direction. All right. And we want to have a magnetic field, uniform magnetic field, in the same direction, or a dipole magnetic field. Okay? Then, what is the relation between the vector potential and the magnetic field? That is simply B equals delta C. Right? Now, if I want to get a solution for this, so this is a differential equation. Okay? If I want to get a solution for this, I will need to use a trick to go from delta cross A to some integral of A. What is that trick? Somebody's theory, mathematics. Stokes theorem, right? So, if you integrate the magnetic field, if you calculate the flux of the magnetic field, B, through some area, and ds is the area, okay, b dot ds is the direction for the area, is the flux through that area. On the right hand side, we have this integral. And Stokes theorem says the integral of the curl of something through an area equals line integral of that something, an enclosed contour, closed path, and closing the area. Right? That's just mathematics, that's Stokes theorem. Now, the left hand side of this is simply the flux, okay? Macroscopic flux, and I'm now considering this following situation. Here is the magnetic axis of the star, okay? And I'm considering a situation, which is what I want, that will minimize the energy, free energy, where there is a B field in that direction. The situation is symmetric with respect to the magnetic moment axis of the star. So I look at a macroscopic distance R, a radius R from the magnetic axis. That means R is some number like 10 to the 5, 10 to the 6 centimeters of the dimensions of the star. And I choose, because I have a symmetry, I just choose a circular contour. Then the flux inside this is, of course, if I assume uniform B, is from B zero times pi R squared. Again, why do I assume a uniform B? Because what you showed me in your homework is, for minimum energy, it should be the same area. So I choose B to be uniform, all right? This left-hand side is simply B zero times the area of the circle, okay? And the right-hand side over here is, what is the right-hand side here? A is going to have the same value at a given R because of symmetry, so I take A outside the integral. And what is the length of a circle? 2 pi R. So A of R times 2 pi R. And from these two things, B solution of the definition of the vector potential that was A equals B, you transform it by this integral and you use the symmetry. Under symmetry conditions, A is simply equal to 1/2 B times alpha. Right? Okay? Just to keep in mind, so we go back and forth between B and A. Now, we come here. What was my argument? I want to introduce this uniform B0. That means I want to introduce an A field like that. Okay? Now you tell me, if the other term is zero, if this were zero, then B would be what? The velocity would be what? Forget to minus, I just want the magnitude. And that is then okay. Now question to you. For 10 to 12 Gauss. Well, first of all, just without putting the value of B, what is this combination E, B over MC?
It's a frequency.
What frequency is it?
I think we discussed it before, right?
This is a cyclotron frequency. Now, the velocity field that is needed, please listen for a moment. Sorry, resistance. The velocity field that is needed to set up this B and this A is of this form. 1/2 times the frequency times R. Frequency times R, this is how the velocity, linear velocity increases with R. What kind of field, what kind of flow is this? What kind of velocity?
Angular. Angular.
It's rotation. Right? Because it's rigid body rotation. Because if you rotate with rigid body rotation, that produces a velocity. Now, the star is rotating, but it's rotating at omega, which is like 100 radians per second for young pulsars. And indeed, last time we learned to make the star rotate with 100 radians per second is easy because you put in a London field and that London field is tiny. It's like 10 to the minus, I forget what. And the energy it takes is nothing compared to the energy gain you have by rotating the system. We have that already. But this is something else. This is saying it's the other way around. If we want to put magnetic field into a superconductor, and if you want to do it without doing anything with this grad phi, if you want to choose this to be zero, then necessarily introducing such a magnetic field would introduce, make the proton superconductor rotate. At what frequency? At half the cyclotron frequency. Now let us do a little exercise. This is homework. I won't spend time doing it here. Find this. Okay. Find what kind of velocity you will find. Okay. Just to put in other words, if you were taking in the actual 10 to 12 Gauss field as if it were a London field, what kind of magnetic, what kind of induced rotation rate you would have? Okay? Find the numbers yourself. And corresponding to this also, R is a macroscopic dimension in the neutron star. So R is like 10 to 6 centimeters or 10 to 5 centimeters or something. This is a macroscopic element. Okay? So do it for 10 to 6. Now, I would like you to just find these numbers, but you will find that this is very large speed. Okay? It will even be larger than C. In any case, it will be so large that this shows that you cannot introduce a magnetic field without generating a huge amount of rotation. If you don't introduce this to me. Okay? So now I'll continue, so I'll argue that you will generate, if you don't have this term, putting a 10 to 12 Gauss field is impossible because it will cost a lot of energy, which you don't have. And there you don't have on the system, requires only to rotate it by 100 radians per second. But field constraint on the system requires, if you don't do something about this term, a huge velocity. Okay? The details, the numbers you will find out. Since we have done, you will have done this part, I also ask you to do a later part. Calculate the energy quantum, h bar omega c. For protons, so here we are talking about protons, proton cyclotron frequency, okay? And while you are at it, do the same thing for the electron cyclotron frequency. This motion, whether it is done in the neutron star, on the neutron star surface by electrons or protons, will cause, of course, a typical deviated photon frequency to excite such cyclotron motions. Photons of that frequency will be absorbed. And this is important because we do observe that energy as an absorption energy in the X-ray spectrum of high mass X-ray bindings. That's how we can measure that there's a surface field of 10 to 12 Gauss. We have not yet observed, there are some candidates that could be, and maybe we have observed, the corresponding proton cyclotron line on the surfaces of some magneta, some objects, okay? So you will learn something important in astrophysics. What are the absorption line energies for electron or proton cyclotron excitations to go from one cyclotron to the next lambda level, for example, it will absorb it, right? That's the side part of your homework. Okay? This homework I would like to miss. It's just a very simple calculation. Alright, now coming back here, what have we shown? We have shown that to introduce a magnetic field, you necessarily have to introduce this, some non-zero grad phi, such that this term cancels or provides again this term without needing an induced, an impossible rotation. So you want to have this zero. Okay? Because whatever we have for the 100 radian per second rotation rate, we have already done that. We have done that by putting a tiny, tiny magnetic field, London field, and we have already rotated it. We don't want any more rotation. Any rotation that has to be coming together with A or B has to be completely cancelled by this term to make this zero. Okay? So now, any questions? Let me repeat. In the last lecture, we already discussed how can we rotate the proton superconductors. And there we said, without introducing this term at all, there is a certain value of the field that will give you the required rotation rate, which is 100 radians per second. We calculated that field. That's a tiny, tiny field. It's 10 to the minus, I forget what. Okay? And we then calculated the energy needed to introduce that field. That's a small fraction of the free energy gain that you get by doing this. Okay, so it will happen. So we took care of exactly rotating the proton superconductor at the rate needed by thermodynamics to have the same rotation rate everywhere in the star, right? That's finished. So anything more that you do connected with magnetic field has to only give you a magnetic field and no rotation, because we already got the rotation we wanted. Alright? Therefore, anything that you do with the magnetic field will need to be done with this. I have particularly asked you, please listen. I have particularly given you this homework to show you that if you still want to keep this zero, that means go on with the London field, the extra rotation for a 10 to 12 Gauss B is impossible. But even if it was not impossible, even if it was small, we already solved that problem. Okay? So to cut it short, we have two constraints on the system. One, to rotate it at 100 radians per second. Two, to introduce a magnetic field B, which is 10 to 12 Gauss. We have already solved and found the equilibrium state for the first one, okay, by the London field. But this field is, the actual field is so much larger than the London field, you cannot just do it with the same trick. You have to say, I'm not going to have any additional rotation because of introducing the field. I have already rotated it. Okay? So, to introduce my second constraint, put in a magnetic field into the star, there is no escape but to have a non-zero term here. Okay? Now, this brings me to a discussion of the Meissner effect in superconductors. If you take a course on superconductors or read about superconductors, you say that superconductors typically
expand the magnetic field. Now you have to be careful, you have to qualify that statement. Superconductors do not expand magnetic fields, period. If the superconductor is going to rotate, it has to have a certain amount of magnetic field, the London field, to allow it to rotate. Okay? So there is no categorical thing that there is no magnetic field possible at all in superconductors. If the system is rotating, a certain tiny magnetic field is actually required. Okay? On top of that, if the system has a magnetic moment constraint, then the minimum energy state requires to have an average, macroscopic average B field to be present. So again, there is no magnetic field expansion, there is no Meissner effect. So the Meissner effect is true if there is no constraint on the system requiring it to have either a magnetic field and or a rotation. Then there is no, because if you put a magnetic field when there is no energy need, when there is no constraint on the system, you would spuriously generate, make the system move, and that costs kinetic energy. Okay, that's the Meissner effect. So if there are no constraints, yes, Meissner effect, no magnetic field. If the system is magnetized, there is an external magnetic moment on it that it can't get rid of, then there is no Meissner effect. You would find a way of putting the magnetic energy in. Or if the system is rotating again, there is no magnetic, there is no Meissner effect because you rotate it by introducing a tiny field. So Meissner effect is not an absolute theory. It's only true if there are no constraints on the system. This is clear. In the case of the neutron star, there are two constraints. One to rotate it. This you do by introducing a London field, very small. Second, there is a magnetic moment and you need to have macroscopic average field 10 to 12 joules, and this you realize as we will explain without putting in extra rotation, just putting in the field and balancing in this. All right?
What is this sex 2 multiplied in front of the velocity?
Huh?
It says 2 times velocity.
E. This one, here.
No, on the top.
Here.
No, in between. 2b equals to 0.
Before then equal to 0. 2b equal to 0. No extra kinetic energy.
2b. No extra kinetic energy.
This is not 2b, this is and. Sorry. V equals this and this. And at the same time, v should be 0. Because the v for rotation into here. This is just telling you what I just have been telling you. Okay, this is that. I don't know what I can't correct. Please, this is that. Okay. You kept saying, I couldn't even find it because that doesn't look like it. Okay. So here we are. Our A has to be equal to the gradient of something. Right? But that cross A is B. And that is not zero. But if you have a gradient of something and if this thing is bad behaved, not singular, usually for continuous function, the delta cross, the curl of a gradient is zero. So phi has singularities. This is now coming back, it's exactly the same argument as we had for rotation of the neutral superfluid. For neutral superfluid, you just have B. And there is no charge, so this wasn't there. But again, you had an equation like that. You had some velocity field equal to grad phi, and this thing was a rotation field with curve. Therefore, this has to have singularities. Here, we have this is zero, but there is this term, and this equals that. So you have the same equation between A and the gradient of phi. Its curve is not going to be zero because curl A, that was A, is B. So the only way out of this difficulty is to say that grad phi is not a nice continuous function by itself, is not? It has singularities. Alright?
And the rest of the argument is similar to what we did before in vortices, except now it's something else. So we want to do this. And this pi has to be singular. So let's say I am now repeating in a new situation the same kind of argument as we had in vortex lines 2 weeks ago. So suppose this red point is a point in the plane perpendicular to the magnetic axis. Okay? This is a point, some point, for whatever reason, we pretend we don't know it, although you already know it. There's something funny here, it's a singular point. Far from the singular point, you have this function phi, which is the phase of your wave function. Since you have a point, you look at the situation, it's symmetric with respect to that point. That means we use polar coordinates with respect to that point. So there is r and there is theta, the polar coordinates. Phi must be a single valued function of r and theta. Okay? Not phi itself, but phi is the phase of our wave function, so we have e to the I phi. Now, if you go around this point, changing theta from zero back to the same point, theta now increased by 2 pi, the function phi must give you the same result in e to the I phi. Okay? So, e to the I phi must have now increased by I times n times 2 pi. And that's only possible if phi itself is n times theta. Theta goes through a rotation by pi, by 2 pi. Okay? Phi is a function of theta. Only if phi is n times theta will become n times 2 pi. Alright? So our solution says phi must be n times theta. Now, if you take the gradient in polar coordinates, the component of the gradient, what's the gradient? Taking derivative with respect to all the coordinates. And if you have curvilinear coordinates, general coordinates, then there are sometimes factors in front of the gradient, basically to give it dimensions of 1 over length. It's a space derivative. Okay, if you just take a derivative with respect to theta, that's dimensionless. In any case, you can look up from books. Gradient of function phi, its theta component, is simply pointed along the theta direction like that. And its value is n over r. So now, a dot dl around here will be simply the gradient of phi, this thing, integrated under the contour. Again, I'm using Stokes theorem. Okay. A dot dl is that cosine over the surface, that means back, integrate a around, and a is just proportional to grad phi, and grad phi is simply 1 over r, taking things out. Okay. So we find that the integral of a dot dl, which is the same thing as the flux enclosed within any line enclosing your singularity. This is the flux enclosed. Okay? This is B times the area. If that flux, the 1 over R cancels the line integral of R d theta, that's the end. Okay? So it's just d theta. Integral of d theta is just 2 pi. Okay. This is exactly the same argument we did for vortex line. In that case, only the context was different and the constants in front were different. And we found that circulation around the vortex line was quantized. It was n times some number kappa. And this time, this time we can use the flux sample, the flux on this singularity, no matter whether you make a very small or very large contour and causing a singularity, the flux will be n times h, the Planck constant, c over 2e. Okay? So this is called the contour of flux. So we have shown that it is possible to introduce flux at singular points, but this is perpendicular, so on singular lines, each of which carries some n, 1, 2, 3, 4, quanta bits of flux, okay? And to get a uniform field, its minimum energy situation is you choose n equals 1, and you have lots of these lines, and that will be equivalent to introducing macroscopic subflux. We'll now show that next. Okay? So the first contour, if you put in CGS units, now this one is 2, okay? 2 times E for 40 times 10 to minus 10 electrostatics, you see 3 times 10 to the 10 centimeters per second, and H is the Planck constant, 6.67 times 10 to minus 27 in CGS units, we keep using CGS. Okay, then this is the value, 2 times 10 to the minus 7, and the unit is Gauss centimeter square. And now I go on to the next part of the argument, which is just the same as what we did with the vortex line. So we understand that each little vortex line carries a plus contour phi 0. If I have the distribution of these vortex lines, lots of them. Suppose there are some number n, little n vortex lines per centimeter square. Okay? Then what is the, then I want to find what is the average magnetic field B. In reality, the magnetic field is zero everywhere, all over, except at these points or on these lines, where it is the value 2 times 10 to the minus 7, stuck on the line. Okay? So to find the here, if I now want to ask what is the macroscopic field, the total flux of this field through here is just the total number of these lines, okay, times pi r squared times pi 0. It's also equal to the macroscopic integral, a big contour like the star size, pi equals 10 to 5, 10 to 6 centimeters, of this A. And if you go through this, I have to do it down again because we did the same thing for the vortex lines. Okay? You end up by saying finding, not saying finding. Okay? The number per centimeter square, NF, of flux lines needed is as follows. This many flux lines per centimeter square times each of them has flux contour phi 0. This product mimics is equivalent to giving 10 to 12 Gauss. From this you can find NF is simply B over phi. So if you take B is 10 to 12 Gauss, divide that by 2 times 10 to the minus 7, that gives you number density. And number density is like you can define a length, typical length between neighboring flux lines. So there is one line per this length L squared. So you find typical length between flux lines. And that length is like 500 Fermi if the magnetic field is 10 to 12 joules. Okay? Basic homework. Find this for millisecond pulsars and for magnetars. Okay? Flux lines are not just thin mathematical lines. Things start to diverge as you go towards the center. Okay? But you cannot have a physical singularity. So at some point, what will happen? There will be enough increasing kinetic energy around that line that instead of staying in the superconducting phase and belonging to this wave function into the I-phi and everything, and they're rotating together around the line very rapidly. That, instead of doing that, some of the particles very close to the line actually get out of the superconducting phase and get in the normal phase. And that happens at a critical radius that we calculated last time. Same thing applies here. Okay? So, around the center of this flux line, there is a little column, and this column has typical radius called the coherence length for the proton superfluid. It's just like the coherence length for the neutron superfluid, same argument. Okay? But in addition, the structure of a flux line is richer. Why? Because there is also charge. There is current, and so there is not just velocity due to the singularity, the 1 over r velocity field, okay? Local velocity, not the big velocity, that's zero, okay? But there is also magnetic field, so you have to solve the structure for how is the magnetic field behaving. It has to drop to zero, far outside the flux line, but at the center of the flux line, there is some local magnetic field that adds up, gives you, within a certain size, the total quantized flux of 2 times 10 to the minus 7. But outside that, field has to die. How does it die? You have to solve for the structure. Okay? So we need to look at our equation. Now, here's our equation. We said macroscopically the left hand side is 0. There is no average rotation, it's sure. But microscopically, so very close to the line, there is a gradient of phi, which says 1 over r, so there is a local perturbation velocity. Okay? And that local velocity is simply, with the general formula, the local velocity is this. Okay? This is the microscopic velocity. Far away it will be zero. Far from inland. Is this clear? Now, if the velocity is this, then there is an electromagnetic current, which is this. M is the number density of the protons, E is the charge. If all the protons are circulating according to this formula, then there will be an electromagnetic current. If there is an electromagnetic current, According to Ampere's law, that cross B is, this is B, that cross B is 4 pi over C times J. So it is this, and then around the singularity, we already found that the local velocity field does decay at 1 over r. So there is a source term here, 1 over r. Okay? And in addition, there is A. Okay? Because it comes from the region. On the left hand side, that cross B is that cross A. So you turn, you have now turned this into a differential equation for the vector potential A. Okay? That cross A, if you go through your vector calculus formulas, that cross A is del dot A minus Laplacian of A. Okay? Del dot A is something that you can choose at your will because it doesn't affect any of the B or E fields. Okay? And the usual thing is to choose a gauge where del dot A is zero. So having done that, then this becomes minus Laplacian of A plus 1 over lambda square times A equals some source term. Okay? So this is one of these relatives of the Laplace equation that occur in mathematical physics. It's called the harmonics equation, is that square plus something times A. If it was zero on the right hand side, it would be the harmonics equation. Now, it is a particular singular source on the right hand side, but of course you solve this. It's not very difficult to solve. This form, this equation for the vector potential, is called the London equation. Because London, this gentleman in London, was the first person studying these things. Okay? And this length here, length K, contains n times e because of the current and e over mc because of these things here. Okay? So this is length. It's called the lambda length. Okay? Now, this is very easy to remember and instructive. Recognize that this combination is the square of the plasma frequency. How many people have seen the plasma frequency? So if you go back to some lecture notes, others, if you haven't seen it, you will see it later. It's the frequency that comes up when you have a plasma with separate charges, pluses and minuses, and these charges, of course, they can never get very far apart from each other. They oscillate with respect to each other because there's charge neutrality. This is a typical oscillation frequency in a plasma. Okay? And that frequency determines how a plasma can absorb energy from electromagnetic radiations. Okay? And the plasma will not pass electromagnetic radiation at lower frequencies. For example, Earth's ionosphere does not pass because it's ionized. It does not pass low frequencies, replace them. That's why I use it for radio and television broadcasts, like a mirror. Okay? Anyway, if you go to some electromagnetism or some book, there will be examples about plasma frequencies. Now, here it occurs, of course, there are charges, that's why it occurs. And the natural length that you build in this problem is built from the plasma frequency tangent and C. So lambda length is C divided by the plasma frequency. Okay? Any questions? Now, the solution of the equation. It requires some special Bessel type functions, but the important thing is the asymptotic behavior. It's like this. The velocity contribution The current, the electromagnetic current, which is proportional to the contribution, is 1 over r, as in the case of the local velocity contribution around the neutron vortex time. We already found that, that was 1 over r, we solved it exactly, okay? But this time is like screened, velocity field is screened, e to the minus r times lambda. Okay, the current falls off like that. Why is that? Because the current around the flux line, okay, is screening the flux, is killing the total field outside. It makes sure that that the local field goes from some peak field of like 10 to 15 Gauss at the center to make up within a length scale lambda, it builds up exactly the quantized flux 2 times 10 to the minus 7. And if you integrate the flux, it rapidly falls around lambda, that length scale, exponentially coupled like a screen field. Okay? So the current is 1 over r, but short range. Yes?
What are the boundary conditions here?
Boundary conditions? Yes. Good question. Boundary condition is, of course, that the B field drops to zero when r is far from your flux. So if you solve for an isolated flux, then you say, okay, boundary condition infinity is that B field or the A field. So A field is, A field is like that, but the B field or the total flux, so boundary condition infinity is that B is zero, because J is zero. So when you solve it, seeing the symmetry around this line, there will be the asymptotic behavior of these functions, which are some combinations of Bessel functions. It will either be like e to the r over lambda plus r over lambda over r, which you throw out, that's not physical, to satisfy your boundary condition. Okay? Divided by r, or the other one, which is this one. Okay? And the meaning of that boundary condition, huh?
Also, in the z direction.
Z direction, you don't have to do anything. Z direction, everything is the same. Problem only is, you know, there is symmetry around the z direction, so we do it in two dimensions. Okay? And the meaning of this boundary condition is, as we discussed at the start, you don't want a non-zero velocity in the box superconductor, because that would mean you rotate the superconductor. You don't have that. Remember, at the beginning we said the V on the left-hand side is zero. This V is not that V, but it should go to that V. Okay, so there is a local V, which is, which has to fall off to V equals zero, because macroscopically, in between the flux lines, there is no velocity. If there were average macroscopic velocity, then the thing would rotate. Right? We are solving it without, with the boundary condition that V equals zero as you go far away from the flux line. So that's the boundary condition. That's a big question. Okay, that's why you only have this one. Otherwise, it's a second order differential equation. You do serve it to the plus r lambda. Okay? And then that will give you the appropriate boundary conditions. If the system were rotating, it will give you the rotation velocity. Okay? But here we have already rotated it. We don't want any rotation. Okay? Any questions? So, bunlar bir tarafa çalışırsınız. If you, the other part of the solution is A goes like this. And that process in the mathematical solution is like this delta function. But in reality, as I said, when you come to this other length, the coherence length, it doesn't go all the way through delta function. So you have two lengths. One length lambda, at which the field drops. And another length xi, at which the superconductivity ends. Okay?
Let me now continue.
So this summarizes, I will go, I'm not going to, I've said this many times. And in fact, I'll stop because I'll tell you what I will do next time. Next time, I'll go back to the rotation of the neutron. lines. So far we have understood what is the structure of the vortex line, what is the structure of the vortex line. So let's go back to the vortex line. Vortex lines, we understand the structure. We understand that if you put a constant density of them, they make the system rotate. Now, if the system is spinning down, that means you have to have less density. So if the density was like this, then they have to diffuse outwards, okay, to spin the system down. How do they know that the system has to spin down? Well, the cores are made of normal matter. They interact with other normal matter, like the electrons, which interact very quickly with the outer crust of the neutron star, which know that there are torques and spinning down. Then this will information will set up a relative velocity between the electrons and the neutrons. So the electrons will scatter somehow from the neutron vortex lines. That will make a force on the vortex lines. The result will be that vortex lines will start moving gradually, radially outwards. So the vortex lattice will become less dense. Therefore, the circuit will spin down. The details here is, what is the equation of motion of a vortex line? And what are the forces of it? So how does it respond to forces, and what are the forces that couple electrons to the neutron vortex? On the basis of this, there are different situations, and this is the basis for understanding how superfluid neutrons in the neutron star spin down or spin up. And this is the basis of all set of theory that I've been working on in geology to understand how pulsars spin down, what happens to superfluid when pulsars spin down, what happens in glitches and so on. So that will be our last lecture. Next Monday. And then I want you to bring these homework problems next Monday. I will give you some more homework, possibly. And then I'm going to ask Kai and Massimiliano to bring up some possible questions. I'll put together my questions and we will give you a take-home final for the whole course. And sometime in the end of May, I will send you this take-home. And you promise, of course, that everybody does it separately on their own. And then I will get back your results and the grade. I will be grateful, of course, together with, of course, your homework grades. Okay? Any questions?